So let me introduce myself. My name is Stephanie and I'm still 20 years old. So gak beda jauh dengan kalian, bahkan setara dengan kalian. And I am the president of HATS currently and I am in my fifth semester management 2019 and I'm currently studying in Hasanuddin University. So the goal of today's workshop that we are going to analyze the shift that happens in the status quo, which we sometimes are not aware of happening. And today's workshop, we are going, it's going to be fun, inspiring, and interactive. So let's just stay tuned and enjoy the workshop. So firstly, we are going to talk the guide for today's workshop. What are the topics that are going to be covered in today's workshop? Firstly, we are going to talk and define what actually entrepreneurship is. It's not your common definition that you sometimes yang kalian biasa dengar di kehidupan sehari-hari. Entrepreneurship is not like that. So we're going to talk about the definition. What are the actual definition of entrepreneurship? Secondly, we are going to talk about the types of entrepreneurs. We are going to understand the deeper levels of entrepreneur. Entrepreneur doesn't necessarily have to be a person who owns a business. It doesn't necessarily be like that. So we're going to talk about that. Thirdly, we are going to talk about what does it take to be an entrepreneur? How do you become an entrepreneur? How an individual be called an entrepreneur? Fourth, we're going to talk about the problems that problems that are faced by millennials and Gen Zs due to the rise of entrepreneurship in status quo. For a fifth, we are going to talk about the problems that are faced due to those problems. And then we're going to talk how to deal with those problems. So first topic that we are going to talk about, so what is entrepreneurship? Nah, pada bahasa awamnya entrepreneurship ya secara harfiah itu ya kewirausahaan kan. Kalian secara awam tahu kalau entrepreneurship atau kewirausahaan itu someone that owns a small business or someone who owns a business. But it's not necessarily have to be like that. So entrepreneurship, you know, it's not an occupation actually. Entrepreneurship, what are entrepreneurship? So it is a characteristic when someone utilizes their own potential to work or produce value for themselves and the values that they hold. So let us analyze here. Kita sama-sama menganalisa entrepreneurship. So entrepreneurship itu sebuah karakter. It's a mindset that someone implements in their self gitu. Kalau ini keadaan di mana seseorang itu menggunakan potensial atau skill yang mereka punya, keterampilan yang mereka punya, itu bukan untuk meet someone else's goals. Bukan untuk bekerja untuk orang lain, tapi bekerja untuk nilai yang mereka anut. Bekerja untuk tujuan dari diri mereka sendiri. Jadi entrepreneurship itu is basically a self-leadership. Itu kalian sebagai leader untuk diri kalian sendiri. Jadi entrepreneurship itu bukan kayak orang yang buka toko atau orang yang doesn't necessarily have to be like that. That is entrepreneur, ya. Tapi it doesn't have to be like that. We are going to talk about further onto that. So sekarang definisi yang kalian pada awalnya initially thought that entrepreneurship is an occupation is actually not. Nah, let us clear define that. Kalau entrepreneurship itu adalah karakter. Entrepreneurship itu adalah yourself leader. You are self leading yourself. Itu. So, the Global Entrepreneurship Institute itu mengembangkan 7 tipe entrepreneur. Ada 7 tipe. Yang pertama, small business, lifestyle, and family entrepreneurs. This is something that we are so common. This is something yang kita familiar with, gitu, that we familiar with. Kalau people who have small business, itu, yeah, of course, they're entrepreneur. Why? Because they lead themselves. Mereka own that business to meet their own goal, misalnya. They create those business based on their passion to meet their own goal. Contohnya, seseorang yang misalnya passion di bidang komputer gitu, terus dia have a small business untuk ngejual komputer atau misalnya ngejual komputer atau bikin program of the computer and stuff. Tapi tujuan akhirnya itu yaitu financial freedom. So they utilize their skills and their passion to meet their own tujuan gitu, their own goal, which is financial freedom, right? Dia utilize kayak gitu untuk melakukan tujuannya sendiri. Nah, ini this is a very common type entrepreneur yang bisa kalian lihat di mana-mana. Second, there is a franchise entrepreneur. Nah, franchise. Nah, ini people yang menggunakan menggunakan merek dagang orang lain gitu. The merek dagang in this case, which is a franchise. Gitu. Misalnya ada artis yang buka toko roti gitu. Nah, atas nama artis itu. Jadi dia menggunakan franchise-nya untuk buka di kota lain misalnya, dan di kota lain itu di-manage dengan seseorang yang ngebeli franchise dari si artis tersebut. Nah, ini salah satu entrepreneur namanya franchise entrepreneur yang dikategorikan oleh Global Entrepreneurship Institute. This is something yang very common lah. It's yang kalian sebenarnya sudah bisa lihat dan analyze di sekitar kalian. Thirdly, there is professional fast growth and serial entrepreneurs. Fourthly, there is corporate entrepreneurs and intrapreneurs. Nah, ini dua kategori ini kurang lebih sama. Nah, professional fast growth itu entrepreneur atau people yang punya bisnis yang sudah mulai besar. Sedangkan kalau corporate entrepreneur itu sudah di level corporate, sudah ada di level perusahaan yang besar gitu. Nah, professional fast growth itu contohnya kayak apa? Kayak misalnya small business yang UMKM gitu yang sudah mulai besar, yang sudah bisa jadi PT gitu, yang sudah dilegalkan jadi PT, itu namanya professional fast growth entrepreneurs. Itu orang-orang individu-individu yang mempunyai PT yang masih kecil kayak gitu. Nah, kalau corporate entrepreneurs itu ya seperti yang kalian bisa lihat PT-PT yang sudah besar gitu, itu merupakan corporate entrepreneurs. Nah, there is this word namanya intrapreneurs. Jadi difference between entrepreneurs and intrapreneurs itu apa? Nah, entrepreneurs, like I've said before, kalau entrepreneurs itu orang yang mengutilisasikan skillnya untuk reach their own goal kan. Kalau intrapreneurs itu orang yang berada di suatu perusahaan, misalnya manager. Manager, they utilize their skill in the organization, in those organization to meet their own desire goal gitu. Jadi basically, jadi dia dia manager itu membuat suatu goal untuk perusahaan itu gitu. Jadi itu yang dinamakan entrepreneurs. It's different with entrepreneurs. Kalau entrepreneurs itu lebih ke personal, kalau entrepreneurs itu lebih ke corporate level or organizational level gitu. Nah, then moving on, there is creative disruptors and innovators. Nah, ini creative disruptors and innovators is basically person who are from the future, who create a better innovation for the world. Contohnya saya kayak Elon Musk dengan his mission to go to the Mars with his SpaceX gitu. It's a kind of ridiculous idea, but it's an innovation gitu. So that is one of the types of entrepreneurs. And moving on, there is extreme entrepreneurs. Nah, extreme entrepreneurs itu adalah orang-orang atau individu yang mau nge-reach their own goal, tapi it doesn't necessarily have to be a business gitu. Kayak misalnya kayak atlet gitu. Kalau atlet kan their own goal is not to make money actually, because they do their athlete stuff because they love their body gitu. Karena dia love their body, they love the sport that they are doing. It's their passion gitu. So it's called what it's called extreme entrepreneurs. They doesn't necessarily have to gain money from it you. And then at the end of the type of entrepreneurs, there's social and non-profit entrepreneurs. Ini bagi individu atau institute yang memang have their own personal goals to give back to the local community, which they believe is a sacred thing to do or it's an essential thing to do. So it's categorized into the category social and non-profit entrepreneurs. Dari ketujuh tipe entrepreneur ini, kita bisa menganalisa kalau ini semua itu based on the individual goal gitu, bukan someone else's goal. Jadi ini semua motivasinya itu purely from what they want and what are their goals in life gitu. Nah, Kalau kayak gitu, then what does it take to be an entrepreneur? Entrepreneur basically is a self-leading yourself. You yourself lead yourself, right? So what does it take to be an entrepreneur? Firstly, you have to have curiosity. So successful entrepreneurs have a sense of curiosity that allows them to continuously seek new opportunities. Rather than settling for what they think they know, curious entrepreneurs ask challenging questions and explore different avenues. Jadi, untuk menjadi seorang entrepreneur itu kalian harus bisa have a high curiosity. Harus kalian bisa menganalisa kenapa sesuatu terjadi. Misalnya, contohnya, like, misalnya ada senior kalian gitu, bisa dapat juara satu nasional. Rather than comparing yourself to them, kalian bisa curious, what does it take to be a champion gitu. Bagaimana journey-nya? Bagaimana caranya untuk jadi juara satu kayak gitu. Itu you is not a comparison but rather a curiosity. Bagaimana caranya orang lain dapat beasiswa gitu. Kira-kira prosesnya kayak gimana gitu. Itu salah satu contoh kecil di kehidupan your university life and how you utilize your curiosity gitu, rather than kayak masa bodoh or kayak nggak mau tahu gitu. Curious to be an entrepreneur, you have to have a high curiosity gitu. Next, you have to have experimentation. Nah, with each new opportunity that arises, an entrepreneur must run tests to determine if it's worthwhile to pursue. Nah, to be an entrepreneur, kalian harus bisa eksperimen. Kalian harus bisa ngebuktiin kalau hipotesis atau pikiran atau ide-ide kalian itu bisa diimplementasi melalui experimentation, you know. Nah, sama kayak di lab gitu. Banyak kan kalau misalnya jurusan ini, jurusan biologi, jurusan apa, jurusan dokter kayak gitu kan mereka ngetes hipotesis mereka di lab itu melalui experimentation. Sama ini you implement it in your life gitu. You experiment what you think you know, whether that turns out to be true or not. Itu turns out to be true or not, itu urusan belakang. Yang penting kalian bisa and have the courage to experiment. Gitu. Thirdly, kalian juga harus bisa, to be an entrepreneur, you have to have high adaptability. So entrepreneurship is an iterative process, and new challenges and opportunities present themselves at every turn. It's nearly impossible to be prepared at every scenario. Entrepreneurs need to evaluate situations and adapt. So, di kehidupan ini tuh, there is nothing that can be predicted. Gitu. You have to have a high adaptability to be ready at all costs. Gitu. Apapun senario yang kalian dapatkan di kehidupan ini, gitu, itu kalian harus siap. Gitu. Harus bisa adapt with the surrounding that's so dynamic. Gitu. Surrounding kita itu selalu berubah-ubah dan tidak ada yang pernah konstan. Ya kalau mau konstan terus ya nggak pernah berkembang gitu. Maka untuk to become a highly individual yang mau jadi entrepreneur, itu you have to have a high adaptability. Kalian harus bisa beradaptasi dengan lingkungan kalian. Harus bisa ready dengan every perubahan yang ada di kehidupan kalian. Fourthly, kalian juga harus to have this decisiveness. Being decisive doesn't always mean having all the answers. If you want to be an entrepreneur, it means having the confidence to make challenging decisions and see them through. If the outcome turns out to be less than favorable, the decisions to take corrective action is just as important. Nah, contohnya gini, contoh kecil saja yang biasa kita hadapi di kehidupan ini, misalnya kayak kita gathering with our friends, gitu. And then our friends ask, where do you want to eat? And then you say, like, it's up to you. No, entrepreneur is not like that. And it's the little thing that counts. Nah, you have to have your own decision. Whether or not the decision turns out to be favorable or not, itu urusan belakang. Kalian harus bisa nge-train your thoughts, gitu, untuk bisa ngambil keputusan. Nah, gini. In the status quo, there are so many options, kan? Ada banyak sekali opsi-opsi yang ada. Contoh kecil saya, kita mau pergi makan. Ada banyak sekali opsi. Misalnya, mau pergi makan pizza, mau pergi makan di restoran Chinese food, or Korean food, Japanese food. There are so many options. Now, how to be decisive as an entrepreneur? how to be decisive is you have to limit your option. Kalian harus bisa pelan-pelan limit option kalian from five option, you limit it to 3 options, and then you have to choose from it, gitu. Decisive, it implements also in other aspect of your life. It doesn't necessarily have to be kayak mau makan di mana or something like that. No, even big decisions in your life, whether or not the option that you choose turns out to be favorable or not, itu urusan belakang. Yang penting kalian harus bisa have your own foundation, have your own pendirian, gitu. Itu decisiveness. It's something that cannot be correct at the very first try, gitu. It doesn't it doesn't happen overnight. Itu is a repetitive process, is a repetitive practice, gitu. So you have to have a strong mindset and strong will to be a decisive person, gitu. Moving on, to be an entrepreneur, you also have to have the skill of team building. Now, a great entrepreneur is aware of their strength and weakness. So, entrepreneur itu tahu, they are self-aware. So, kalau mereka itu punya limitation, mereka nggak selalu ada di atas, mereka nggak selalu, misalnya, the know-it-all girl or the know-it-all person. Nah, itu entrepreneur itu is not like that. Mereka tahu kalau mereka juga punya batasan. Kita juga manusia. We are also a flawed human being yang punya strength and weakness. Thus, rather than letting shortcomings holding them back, they build their well-rounded teams that complement their abilities. It also happens gitu in an organization. Kenapa bisa ada divisi-divisi di setiap organisasi? Karena basically we are a flawed human being. We have our weakness. Now weakness ini yang bisa di cover dengan orang lain. That is the essential part of entrepreneur. Mereka bisa have the skill of team building gitu. Mereka bisa rely on other person, trust other person gitu. To do their part yang mereka mungkin nggak bisa gitu. Ya, entrepreneur itu juga tahu lah limitation-nya di mana. Kita bukan juga orang yang kayak sangat-sangat hebat juga gitu. No, it's not like that. So, to be an entrepreneur is to be a wise person yang tahu themselves. That to be a entrepreneur is a self-awareness, is a self-aware person gitu. Then moving on, entrepreneur juga itu have to have risk tolerance. Jadi ini risk tolerance itu basically mirip lah dengan adaptability. So, successful entrepreneurs are comfortable in encounter some level of risk to reap the rewards of their effort. However, the risk of tolerance is tightly related to their efforts to mitigate it. Nah, jadi to be an entrepreneur is to always take risk at every step gitu. Karena entrepreneur know what they want, dan what they want itu doesn't necessarily selalu fit in dengan society standard. Nah, maka risk tolerance ini harus dibangun di diri seorang entrepreneur. Karena every step of the way itu selalu ada risk. Nah, kalian juga dalam kehidupan juga itu semua ada. Sesimpel saja kita mau kemana, misalnya mau ke mall gitu. Misalnya contoh kecil lagi, kita mau nongki dengan teman-teman kita gitu. Mau ke mall Trans atau mau ke mall Panakukang itu, they have their own risk. Maksudnya kalau kita lewat Trans ya macet, lagi diperbaiki jalan. Kalau ke mall Panakukang mungkin terlalu jauh kayak gitu. Each option have their own risk gitu. Jadi ini juga terimplementasi di kehidupan kita. Contohnya kita mau apply to our own dream university gitu. Ada dua, misalnya UI dengan Unhas. Nah kalau di Unhas misalnya lebih dekat dengan keluarga. Nah kalau di UI karena harus merantau lagi and have their own risk, kayak misalnya nggak dapat kosan atau terlalu jauh dari orang tua, biaya hidup tinggi. Sedangkan kalau misalnya di Makassar mungkin kalian kayak is still in your comfort zone, kalian nggak challenge yourself, nggak terlalu berkembang, etc. etc. Itu banyak sekali risknya. So to be an entrepreneur is to be brave enough to know that that risk is inevitable and to be courage, to have a high courage to face those risks gitu. And then moving on, comfortable with failure. Now, it's estimated that 75% of new startups fail. And the reason for failure are vast and encompass everything from flawed business model, lack of focus or motivation, while many risks can be avoided, some are inevitable. Successful entrepreneurs prepare themselves for and are comfortable with failure. Rather than let fear hold them back, the possibility of success propels them forward now. This is something comfortable with failure. This is something yang gak semua orang punya. You have to note that bahkan saya yakin every single of the participant here have their own insecurity kan. Kalian juga pasti punya insecurity of failure gitu. Kalian pasti punya tekanan untuk tidak melakukan kesalahan. But you have to let those negative thoughts go gitu. Karena failure is something, it is something to be learned from. Failure is a stepping stone for your success. This is something yang selalu di selalu hold people back. Oh, kayak misalnya mau learn a new skill, saya mau belajar bahasa Inggris. Aku takut deh nanti temanku judge saya karena saya sokan Inggris itu. Takut deh nanti susah gitu, IELTS-nya susah. Nanti jadi kayak saya jadi fail gitu. Nanti teman-teman ketawa gitu. No, you have to let those thoughts go. Nah, kalau kalian masih terus di consume with those insecurity, consume with those negative thoughts, kapan kalian bisa maju gitu. So, to be an entrepreneur, kalian harus comfortable with failure. Kalau misalnya entrepreneur yang pengen buat startup business, comfortable that your business might fail at some time, but those failure just won't hold you back to continue on with some new business or continue on with those business gitu. Nah, itu contohnya, itulah salah satu aspek yang sangat-sangat penting to be an entrepreneur. You have to be comfortable with failure. And then, moving on with persistence. Nah, persistence ini related to comfortable with failure karena mostly people, kalau misalnya sudah fail, they sometimes just let it go, let everything go. They just give up like that and not persist gitu. And this is something that cannot be done by an entrepreneur. To be a highly individual person, itu you cannot do that because persistence, while many successful entrepreneurs are comfortable with the possibility of failing, it doesn't mean that they give up easily. Rather than they see failures as an opportunity to learn and grow. Jadi kalau misalnya sudah fail, kalian tetap persist to pursue your goal. There is a quote saying, you have to be fixed for your goal, but you have to be adaptable to your ways to gain that goal gitu. Jadi goalnya itu tetap fix, tapi cara untuk mendapatkan goal itulah yang bisa berubah-ubah. You have to be flexible with your ways to achieve your own goal. Jadi kalau misalnya kalian fail, you have to think other ways of on how you gain those goals gitu. Misalnya mau jadi, misalnya kalian anak-anak universitas kan kayak gini, misalnya mau jadi juara satu nasional gitu. Mungkin pertama kita latihan tiap hari, kita mengikuti lomba antar provinsi, antar regional gitu. Kalau misalnya di situ kalian gak kalah, no, kalian jangan berpikiran bilang gak bisa deh, masa regional aja aku udah kalah gitu. No, you cannot think like that. Kalian itu harus pikir, oh, dari apa ya, aspek apa yang aku yang saya salah gitu. Misalnya mungkin kalau debate Inggrisku kurang baik gitu, bagaimana caranya susun arealnya atau susun argumentationnya itu kayak gimana. Oh, kira-kira saya lebih cocok jadi first speaker atau second speaker atau third speaker gitu. Nah, that is the art of persistence. Kalian harus try new things and try new things to gain your goal gitu. Jadi kalau misalnya pelan-pelan dibelajar, oh kemarin saya kalah karena apa, oh mungkin argumenku kurang dielaborate gitu. Nah, terus kalian bisa mungkin discuss with your coach, with your mentor gitu. Kira-kira kemarin waktu lomba debate itu gimana gitu. Nah, kalau sudah kayak gitu, belajar, you still persist, and then you can gain pelan-pelan menang di regional and then pelan-pelan nanti masuk ke nasional and then you can be the first winner of national competition gitu, misalnya NUDC, KDMI, atau IFET, JOFET kan, itu there's so many other opportunities gitu. To be, the art of persistence is not something that everyone has, so you have to be disciplined with yourself. And then moving on, there's innovation. Nah, innovation is a characteristic of some, but not all entrepreneurial processes. Unfortunately, this innovation is a type of strategic mindset that can be cultivated by developing your strategic thinking skills. You can be well equipped to spot innovative opportunities and position your venture for success. Now, innovation. This is actually that I've already explained that innovation is actually the art of you thinking how to gain those goals. Bagaimana kalian bisa adaptable with your ways. Jadi kalau misalnya satu cara salah, kalian bisa think another ways to gain your goal. It's the art of innovation, strategic thinking. And then moving on, long-term focus. This is the key. Yang saya sudah ulang-ulang bilang tadi, kalau goalnya itu harus fix. This is the key of long-term focus gitu. This is the key of entrepreneur. Mereka sangat stand on their ground, on their goal, that they do not give a damn about everything gitu. Risk, they don't care about risk, they don't care about failure, they don't care what other people say. They are so eager to experiment for their long-term focus ini, for their long-term goal ini gitu. Jadi, to be an entrepreneur, you have to possess this kind of characteristic, yang these 10 characteristic that has been explained to. And then moving on, then what are the problems that happen in startup school? Nah, kalian bisa lihat di sini ada 5 life cycle yang sangat umum yang kita bahkan lagi jalanin sekarang. Yang dari kita kecil itu dikasih tahu ke kita. From our young age gitu, we have been fed by our parents that this is how you are going to live your life. Like you go to kindergarten, you have to behave well in the kindergarten because of course that's your golden age kan, di situ kalian bisa develop your characteristic gitu. Nah, di kindergarten you have to behave well and then you move on towards school. Nah, di school you are pressured to have a good grades by your peers, by your parents, by your teacher even, bahkan teacher itu bahkan discriminate students yang have high scores than students who doesn't have a higher scores gitu. Nah, di school ini kalian di pressure to have a high grade and then to have good grades and then you have to have good grades to apply to good university. Contohnya saja SBMPTN dengan SNMPTN dan SBMPTN kan, untuk masuk UNHAS saja sudah banyak sekali yang tereliminasi karena nilainya kurang bagus, kalian kurang pintar, kalian kurang apa, tidak bisa masuk UNHAS itu. Nah, di sini, and then the mindset, kenapa bisa ada universitas yang difavoritkan, misalnya di Indonesia saja, universitas yang difavoritkan itu UI, UGM, UNHAS, ITB, dan lain-lain, itu banyak sekali. Nah, ini kenapa universitas ini difavoritkan? Karena orang-orang pikir kalau masuk di universitas ini, you will get a good job, right? So you get good grades at school, you get accepted into good university or favorable university, and then you are going to accept it to be a good job, to get a good job gitu, get a good profession. And that is what's problematic in startup school. Karena itu that is a traditional way of thinking, that is a traditional way to live. Meanwhile, sekarang zaman itu sudah evolve gitu. Kalian harus tahu kalau sekarang zaman itu evolve, it doesn't necessarily have to be like this. Kalian get good grades at school and then you get accepted to good favorable university and then you get accepted to good high paying job like that. So that is the status lah. Misalnya, that is the title, high paying job. And that you get a good job, you work for 40 years with little to minimum freedom gitu, misalnya waktu cutinya you sedikit and then you retire at the age of 65 and then what? And then what? You cannot do that at that age. You then at that age 65 you retire like you work all your life just to get that so little time to retire. That is a really traditional ways and old-fashioned ways to live. Like, you do not have a really much freedom in your life. So that is the problem that's happening in status quo. And that problem is called the 9-to-5 scam. So the first picture shows to you, you work 40 years until you can retire. You work for boss that cares nothing about you. You only get 3 weeks of vacation a year. Like I said before, itu adalah scam terbesar yang kita dikasih tahu dari kita masih kecil gitu. Kalau kita bakalan dapat high paying job, we work for someone else untuk salary yang mungkin kita nggak bisa gunakan gitu, karena we do not have time to enjoy those money gitu. Contohnya saja satu minggu kita bekerja dari Senin sampai Jumat. 2 hari kita gunakan untuk apa? 2 hari itu kita gunakan untuk istirahat atau untuk senang-senang. Is it really worth the high paying job? Is it really worth the money? Kayak you stress for 5 days on a job that you probably do not enjoy, on a job that the boss cares nothing about us. So it's really not worth it. Is it really worth? The question is it really worth your time, your freedom for this money, for this amount of money? Nah, salary juga, kan, for a fresh graduate, it's unrealistic to say that when you graduate, misalnya kalian kalau graduate S1 dari UNHAS, kalian bakal dapat gaji 10 juta or 15 juta. It's really unrealistic. Ya, mostly at most itu kalian bakal dapat 5 juta. 5 juta itu untuk apa? 5 juta mungkin 3,5-nya untuk misalnya your apartment or your cost of living, makan, internet, listrik, tempat tinggal gitu. And then the other 2 untuk apa? Untuk senang-senang, untuk saving. So, you do not have time, and those money is also not worth all of your mental and all of your freedom being taken away from you. So, and then the second picture, you have to decide, you work for 40 hours a week and help someone else achieve their dreams for the rest of your life, or you work 80 plus hour a week for 5-10 years, start your own business and live your own dreams. So kalian bisa pilih, kalian mau bekerja mati-matian untuk orang lain, untuk kekayaan orang lain, untuk tujuan orang lain, untuk other people goals. Kalian curahkan skill yang kalian sudah build dari SD sampai kuliah itu untuk orang lain. Kalian pikir apakah it's really worth your time, worth your mental, worth your effort, worth your freedom, rather than kau curahkan itu semua potensial atau keterampilan yang kau punya untuk your own goal gitu. Contoh misalnya, ada banyak perkataan atau banyak pertanyaan yang muncul sebenarnya dari sini. Tapi saya tidak tahu saya mau apa. Nah, inilah yang menjadi problem sebenarnya. Saya tidak tahu tujuanku di hidup apa. Saya hanya mau misalnya, ya kalau sudah kuliah, kerja, terus cari pasangan, terus nikah, terus ya. They do not think long term focus gitu, karena dari kecil kita sudah di brainwash. That is the way of your life. You cannot do it otherwise gitu. That is the safest option ya. That is the safest option. Sudah lulus kuliah, kalian bekerja di korporasi atau di sebuah perusahaan in something that you probably do not passion about, karena realistically saying, kalau misalnya kalian mau misalnya jadi manager suatu perusahaan gitu, most likely kalian nggak bakal jadi manager gitu, karena you are competing not only against your friends in university, but you also competing with other people from other university, from other city, and also not in only in your angkatan, tapi juga di angkatan atas, di angkatan bawahmu. There's so many people that you're competing against that one spot that you really desire. So the probability of you getting that desired spot is really, really slim. So what do we, what actually should we do with our life then? Nah, inilah di sini, as an entrepreneur, they know what to do in their life gitu. They know what are their long-term focus, and then they utilizes their potential untuk gain that gitu. Nah contohnya misalnya seorang saya laki cewek lah cewek, taruhlah seorang perempuan ini, dia sangat-sangat passion, dia sangat-sangat passion terhadap misalnya fashion gitu, misalnya dia really passionate about fashion, they like, she likes to scroll on Instagram looking at pictures of people in nice dress, really fancy dress, and then what does she want to do? When we ask her, what do you want to do? Oh, I want to be a fashion stylist, or I want to be fashion stylist and stuff. And but the probab or I want to work in a corporate that works in fashion gitu. But the probability of her going there is really zero, right? It's really slim, right? So what does she want to do instead? So yang dia value itu adalah yang dia sangat senang itu adalah untuk lihat-lihat baju-baju cantik gitu kan. Jadi dia berusaha untuk start her own business to make a boutique gitu. She make a boutique based on her passion, right? She work for it really really long gitu. She utilizes all of her skills and work 80 plus hour per week untuk buka tokonya sendiri, toko butiknya sendiri gitu. Tapi dia jadi her own boss gitu and not working for other people's dream gitu, for other people's goals. Nah, and she really enjoy it gitu. Jadi it's really about what you willing to sacrifice for. Nah, ini ya, inilah yang namanya 9-to-5 scam. That the retirement age is 60 and then the life expectancy is 75 years, work for 45 years to be a free for 15 years. That is really really worth your time. So it comes back to your own goals. It comes back to what you're willing to sacrifice for. Nah, sebenarnya traditional ways of living itu sebenarnya sudah lama dikecam. Sudah banyak sekali motivator, sudah banyak sekali penulis-penulis buku yang sudah mengecam traditional ways of living gitu. Sudah banyak kayak misalnya YouTuber, not only YouTuber lah, kayak motivators or self-proclaimed entrepreneurs gitu yang sudah mengecam ini, dan sudah banyak kalian bisa lihat sendiri di Instagram atau di other platform gitu, misalnya di Google, di mana, di YouTube, itu sudah banyak sekali yang mengecam. Banyak sekali, this is the phenomenon that's called the rise of entrepreneurship as a career option for you gitu. Ini kalian bisa lihat pertama ini ada mentor business, ada finance millennial, juga ada banyak sekali post-post mengenai entrepreneurship and the problems of living the traditional life gitu. There's so many. Nah, karena banyaknya ini tuh kalian bisa lihat juga ada banyak sekali buku-buku or self-help books yang bisa ngebantu kalian untuk develop your entrepreneurship mindset gitu. Ini banyak sekali buku-buku yang bisa kalian gunakan untuk yang kalian bisa baca untuk build your own self to be an entrepreneur. Nah, karena sudah banyak yang kayak gini dan and also the rise of social media, ini ada tren di mana orang itu flaunting their own skill. Gitu. Contohnya ini Timothy Ronald. Siapa sih yang nggak tahu Timothy Ronald? Nah, Timothy Ronald ini dia itu foundernya dari ternakuang.id. Nah, terus dia buat video dong. Dia buat video di mana dia 20 tahun udah pegang 1 miliar dari skill entrepreneur-nya, dari skill investing-nya, dari skill financial-nya gitu, dari skill yang sudah dia memang belajar gitu. Dia buat videonya dong dan post di social media, so many people view the video. Nah, kayak gini, udah 20 tahun udah punya 20 miliar, udah punya 1 miliar. Terus gimana dapat 100 juta di umur 19 tahun? Nah, kalau kita lihat kayak gini, constant exposure on social media, on other platforms itu kita, especially us, kita baru ABG, anak baru gede gitu, kesannya kayak gimana? Pasti kayak insecure dong, kayak lihat, kita seleting, kita seumuran, tapi ya udah punya 1 miliar. Apa yang bisa saya lakukan gitu. Pegang 10 juta saja masih susah banget gitu. Pegang 50 juta aja apalagi gitu. Ya, ini this constant train of negative thoughts that is consumed to us karena kita lihat di sosial media dia melakukan ini, bagaimana dia menjelaskan bagaimana perjuangannya, of course without any credit to his struggle, dia juga nggak bisa lihat di behind the scene itu dia kayak bagaimana. Misalnya ini memang Timothy Ronald comes from a very wealthy family, that's why he gets so easily gitu. Ada privilege-nya memang dari awal dia sudah di get education gitu dari orang tuanya yang memang mungkin businessman gitu, sudah ada background-nya yang memang privilege gitu. Nah, this is something yang biasa we are not aware of gitu as a Gen Z and millennials untuk ngelihat ke Timothy ini contohnya. Nah, then if that's the case, then what happened? Nah, kita millennials and Gen Z sometimes are not aware that we are consumed by this FOMO. FOMO, what is FOMO? FOMO is a fear of missing out. FOMO is a phenomenon that arises akhir-akhir ini tuh, recently arises. That a study conducted by University of Indonesia shows that more than 60% of young people / millennials, Gen Z's, of social media users develop FOMO symptoms. Nah, contohnya kayak tadi itu Timothy Reynolds itu ngeflown on social media on his YouTube that he got his money from it dari entrepreneurship, his entrepreneurship mindset, his financial skills itu nggak bisa ngebawa juga kalian untuk jadi kayak mereka, tapi dia juga nggak bilang gitu kalau ini saya bisa kayak gini karena apa, dia cuman give you kayak literally how he do it gitu, tapi tanpa ngejelasin backgroundnya dia kayak bagaimana. Nah, karena kurangnya transparansi yang ada di sosial media dan di sosial media dan di sekeliling kita, maka kita develop the FOMO symptoms. Sometimes we are not aware of it. So, symptomsnya apa? Pertama, itu ada anxiety and depression due to constant exposure to new information. Apalagi di social media kan, kalian bisa lihat, oh, kalau this is a wrong way to live, gitu. Kalian harus live with entrepreneurship mindset, with a growth mindset. Kalian harus live like this. This is something yang sekarang benar gitu, dan yang old fashion ways is not correct, it's not relevant anymore. Karena constant new information itu maka membuat kita anxiety karena we lost touch with our reality. What we consume on social media, what we consume daily, itu is not the same with our reality. Thus, it makes us anxiety. Am I living the wrong life? Am I living the right way? Am I not a highly capable individual? Am I not worthy? So there, this constant exposure to new information makes us anxiety and depression. Second, it also reduces our confidence. This is, yeah, nggak munafik. Semua orang, bahkan di room ini, di room Zoom ini, semua pasti mempunyai their own insecurity. Kita pasti ada at some point we are not confident with ourselves. Why this happening? Because due to constant comparison to other people's accomplishments, contohnya kayak tadi, kita lihat ada rising entrepreneur at our age, at 19 years old, at 20 years old, yang sudah bisa accomplish so much dibanding dengan kita. Kita di sini masih living in our parents' roof, hanya bisa bergantung ke orang tua, tanpa bisa menghasilkan kembali, gitu. It reduces our confidence, it makes us wonder what we are living wrong, gitu. Ini a highly toxic, a highly competitiveness in social media itu membuat juga kadang-kadang toxic gitu. Dari semua yang sudah saya jelaskan kayak karakteristiknya entrepreneurship yang mungkin kalian belum punyai, itu kadang juga bisa jadi toxic di pikiran kita kayak apakah kalau saya tidak begitu bagaimana gitu. Kalau saya tidak mempunyai karakter itu kayak gimana? Am I not capable to make my parents happy, or am I not capable enough to make money, or am I not capable enough to gain my own goals, gitu. So it reduces our confidence by a lot, gitu, to have these FOMO symptoms. Thirdly, we also give up easily. Why? Because due to the unrealistic expectation that we held for ourselves. Kita lihat ke orang lain, misalnya Billie Eilish saja sudah bisa jadi billionaire umur 17 tahun kalau nggak salah ya. Umur 17 tahun dia dari singer, dia jadi singer, dia bisa jadi billionaire. Kita jadi compare ourselves to her gitu, kayak she persists, dia kayak have a strong mentality. Kayak kita lihat dia, terus kita juga because we see other people, we give those parameters that we compare other people to ourselves gitu. Parameter yang kita ukur ke orang lain dan parameter yang kita ukur ke diri kita itu sama. Itu it's really unrealistic. That is not something that you should do gitu. Notice, kalian harus tahu kalau parameter untuk setiap orang itu berbeda. Setiap individu saja itu dibuat unik. It's really unique. They have their own strength and weaknesses. So, how holding an unrealistic expectation for yourself will make you give up easily and will not take you to your own goal gitu. Why? And then having those unrealistic expectation will result in you having reduced productivity. Bahkan kalian membuat kalian tidak produktif terhadap cara-caranya kalian untuk reach your own goal gitu. Karena kalian sudah have really weak motivation gitu. So this is symptom yang semua orang punya, kita semua orang punya. So the first step to change it is to be aware of it. So moving on, then how do we deal with this FOMO symptoms? Yang ada 4 symptoms gitu yang ngebuat kita jadi less productive with ourselves. Firstly, we have to know ourselves. What do you want? What do you want in life? What do you value the most in life? What are your goals? And what are your strengths and weaknesses? Itu self-aware is the first step to change. Kalau kalian expect change in your life, then firstly you have to PDKT with yourself. You have to pendekatan ke diri kalian, kalian sendiri. Kalian harus tahu diri kalian, apa yang kalian mau, apa goal kalian, dan apa limitation-nya kalian. Kalian harus tahu, oh saya lebih pintar di bagian ini dibanding bagian ini gitu. Jadi kalian bisa utilize your strength dan bisa pelan-pelan fokus untuk lebih ini weakness-nya kalian gitu. Fokus untuk improve your weakness gitu. So that is the first step. You have to be self-aware. And self-aware, notice that it doesn't happen overnight, okay? Knowing yourself is a process. Knowing yourself is a really long, lifelong journey. People change. Kita, diri kita juga change based on our external lingkungan kita yang selalu dinamis, yang selalu berubah. Jadi diri kita juga pasti berubah. Dan we at all times, we have to ask ourselves back. Gitu. We have to know ourselves. That is the first step to deal with FOMO. Secondly, we have to get in touch with reality. Notice that everything that you consume, whether it's in the misalnya di market, di marketing misalnya yang iklan-iklan ataupun dari sosial media, dari TV or anything, bahkan dari teman kalian gitu, dari perspektif teman kalian, you have to know that not everything that is displayed is real gitu. Kalian nggak tahu behind the scene-nya kayak bagaimana. So do not ever compare yourself with other gitu. That other people have other aspect gitu. Ada aspek lain yang mendukung kenapa bisa dia bisa accomplish things that they accomplish. So when you get in touch with your own reality, then you get to control it. Kalian bisa control diri kalian sendiri. Kalian bisa control realitasnya kalian sendiri. Kalau ya, orang bisa accomplish what they accomplish because ada aspek yang kita tidak bisa lihat dari sini. Then you get to focus to yourself. I can accomplish things that I can accomplish because I control my reality. I control myself. I discipline myself to get my goal gitu. Then that is all for it. Thank you for listening. That is all for the mentorship. For further discussion, I open the Q&A session. If there are any questions about entrepreneurship and stuff, you can ask me directly. Okay, so there is a first question in the Zoom chat box that from Putri Amanda. So I have a question, how to overcome the FOMO again? Nah, untuk overcome FOMO, firstly kalian harus, I already explained that first thing that you have to know anything lah, whether it's FOMO or other things, first thing to change is to know yourself. Know yourself, people. What do you want? What are your goals? What are your strengths and weakness? Kau harus aware gitu. Misalnya contoh, kayak kalian scroll-scroll Instagram terus lihat mulai ada negative thinking. Kenapa dia bisa begini di? Kenapa saya nggak bisa? Firstly, you have to be aware what are your feelings. Oh, sekarang saya lagi berpikir yang negatif. What are your feelings? Apa yang feelingsmu pada saat at that moment itu apa? Kalian harus identify your own feeling first. Oh, I caught up again with this negative thoughts. I caught up again with this constant constant comparison with other people gitu. Kayak atau teman-temanmu cerita misalnya kayak atau misalnya seniormu dapat juara satu gitu terus you have this feeling of kecemburuan or jealousy in your heart gitu, in your brain. Like you have to first be aware of your own feelings first. Like saya lagi cemburu ini. Ah, enggak apa-apa aja saya cemburu. Ah, and then you have to know yourself first. Oh, yeah, memanglah dia juara satu. Tapi my goalku in life is not to be like him. Is to be like me gitu. My goal ini in life apa misalnya? Saya mau jadi businesswoman gitu. Ah, nanti saya punya tokoku sendiri atau nanti saya mau bekerja di perusahaan ini misalnya. My goal is not like him gitu. So firstly you have to know yourself first, apa yang kau mau dari kehidupan. Second, you know your limitation, you know your strength and weakness gitu. Ya berani-berani saja itu tuh bilang, oh memanglah saya punya bahasa Inggris gak terlalu bagus, makanya saya gak bisa debat bahasa Inggris gitu. Tapi saya punya skill yang lain misalnya, tapi saya misalnya bisa yang lain gitu. Contohnya ya I'm good at sport misalnya. Ya saya pintar main tenis atau something like that. You have to know your strength and weakness gitu. Saya rajin kerja kayak gitu toh. And then after you know yourself, you get in touch with your own reality. Kau harus lihat realitasmu apa. Dirimu sendiri dan lingkunganmu sendiri itu bagaimana tuh misalnya ya saya tidak terlalu berprivilege kayak dia ya dia bisa dapat yang dia punya privilege terserah apa saya tidak ada tapi it's okay I can do myself in my own way that life is not a competition so that is the way to overcome this fear of missing out. Yeah. Okay, so another question from Nurul Kirana is Sim bertanya, do you think each of us are capable to be in entrepreneurship since everyone comes from different background just like what you mentioned before? Okay. Yeah, again, entrepreneurship, Nurul Kirana, that entrepreneurship is not an occupation. Entrepreneurship is a mindset, is a self-discipline, is a self-leader. Jadi kau jadi leader untuk dirimu sendiri. Entrepreneurship is to work from your potential, is to utilize your potential to gain your own goal. Jadi I think everyone itu bisa jadi entrepreneur whether or not they come from different background or the same background. Karena ya we have to know kalau misalnya background orang berbeda-beda, dari ajaran orang tua berbeda-beda, dari yang saya sudah jelaskan tadi, kalau dari kita kecil kita di-fed the ways to live like that, kayak we never been asked what do you want in life, kita dari kecil tidak pernah ditanya, oh mau goalmu di life itu apa, no, but dari kecil kita sudah dikasih tahu, kalau you have to go to school, you have to get a good grades, you get to university, and then you get a good job, like that. End of period. So yeah, whether or not you come from different background itu it contributes, tapi dari prosesnya aja mungkin satu orang lebih bisa bisa lebih satu orang itu bisa lebih cepat jadi self leader leader untuk dirinya sendiri, tapi satu orangnya lagi mungkin lebih lama gitu karena ya backgroundnya pelan-pelan dari mentalitas dirinya sendiri gimana. Is there any other question? Okay. Okay, pertanyaan dari Micheline Kwandi. I would like to ask, should I join the entrepreneur group that is trending in Instagram? Yes, you should join. Dan I think it's very helping ya. It's very helping karena di community itu saya juga sendiri ya join ke community-community kayak gitu. I also follow the accounts that focus on building entrepreneurship, entrepreneurial mindset gitu. Nah, it's very helping karena mereka juga share misalnya self-help books or tips-tips untuk misalnya tips-tips untuk focus on your own goal gitu, untuk achieve your own goal. Tapi, oh, wait, ini technical issues. Okay, so, yeah. It's really important, tapi juga jangan sampai overwhelm gitu. Karena biasa kalau sudah kita terlalu sering join ke grup-grup kayak gitu, biasanya kita overwhelmed with so much information that we get in lost with our own reality. Contohnya biasa di entrepreneurial group kayak gitu, biasa dia kayak bilang investing, you have to invest some of your income to invest in saham, stocks, obligations, or crypto or something like that. Yeah, it's a great tips. Dan some may work for some people, tapi mungkin kayak orang kayak saya yang mungkin tidak terlalu ngerti tentang crypto or investing in general, itu will be so overwhelming gitu. I also consider myself as a FOMO juga. Saya dapat juga FOMO, di mana saya merasa investing is a very crucial thing and everyone tends to follow the trend gitu. Contohnya saja biasa, I believe some of your friends also get into the trend of crypto or investing or stuff. Ya, yeah, mereka juga itu a victim of FOMO gitu. Tapi it's not for everyone. So you have to know yourself kalau, oh, it's okay if I do not follow the trend, that this is my limitation, I cannot do that gitu. So, yeah. So you have to know your limitation. Don't caught up into FOMO symptoms gitu. So is there any other question? Okay, so is there any other question? Kalau misalnya tidak ada, kita proceed forward untuk the debate joint practice-nya. The next session. Nah, talking about entrepreneur or entrepreneurial itu, where karena kan ini debate workshop, so we are going to build an argument based on this motion. This house regrets the glorification of becoming an entrepreneur as a career option. Nah, tadi kan saya sudah jelaskan kalau entrepreneur itu is a characteristic, is a mindset gitu. Kalau misalnya kita jadi leadernya dirinya kita sendiri. Tapi saya juga sudah jelaskan ada 7 tipe entrepreneur. So entrepreneur di sini doesn't necessarily have to be a businesswoman or a businessman, tapi anything. Kayak entrepreneur itu sangat-sangat luas. Misalnya, selebgram gitu. Selebgram itu kalian bisa, bukan selebgram lah, kayak atau painter atau digital editor or digital art enthusiast yang share-share di Instagram artnya, terus mereka juga jual, is it count as entrepreneur or not? Of course, it counts as entrepreneur karena mereka follow their passion. Ya, yeah. Art is their passion gitu. Misalnya selebgram lah, selebgram. Selebgram itu tergolong entrepreneur or not? Of course, itu tergantung tergolong entrepreneur. Kenapa? Karena they love content creating. Mereka suka content creating and they do not work for anyone. Mereka work for themselves. Mereka edit videonya sendiri, misalnya contohnya. Mereka edit their own video, mereka buat videonya sendiri, dia buat post their own post themselves, mereka take pictures of themselves gitu, mereka endorse gitu untuk dirinya sendiri. They do not work for anyone. So entrepreneur is the term of not working for anyone but yourself. You utilize your own potential to reach your own goals. Of course, kayak gitu nih. Contohnya saya bilang apa tujuan akhirnya ya. Dia pengen terkenal, dan ya, dari terkenal itu dia dapat banyak endorsement, ya. Ujung-ujungnya financial freedom kan, itu tujuannya. Sama dengan ini, kayak misalnya digital editor atau freelancer lah istilahnya, freelancer di Instagram atau di social media, di mana dia sell their own art, atau ya, yang kayak gitu, itu mereka kan passion dengan artnya mereka, and they have the skill to do it. So they do it, and then they sell it, atau they even display it for their own personal goals gitu. Kan itu termasuk entrepreneur. So entrepreneur is a career. It's a very very broad gitu. So basically entrepreneur is not working for someone else. It's working for yourself. So yeah. So untuk clear it now, so mostly hari ini itu kita bakalan build argument about this house regrets the glorification of becoming an entrepreneur as a career option. Ada yang mau menyuarakan pendapatnya, apakah kalian setuju atau tidak setuju dengan mosi ini dan apa alasannya? Oke, kalau misalnya belum ada, mungkin saya bisa elaborate dulu yang pertama. Nah, kalau misalnya debat itu as a first speaker, ya first speaker, second, third lah. Untuk misalnya, this house regrets the glorification of becoming an entrepreneur as a career option. Nah, kalau yang afirmasi, berarti bahwa kalian itu tidak mau glorifikasi dari being an entrepreneur as a career option. Jadi kalian itu mau tetap traditional way, ya kalian lulus kuliah langsung masuk ke pekerjaan, that may be the safest option, toh masuk pekerjaan, ya traditional way. You what you want in your speech itu adalah your what you want in your world is a traditional way of living gitu, ya working for someone else. Kalau di pihak negatif, kalian mendukung being an entrepreneur, being your own boss, be your own, working for your own goals gitu. Itu kalian yang kalian mau, itu ideal world-nya kalian. So untuk set up the debate itu yang pertama. What know what you want. What do you want in your ideal world? Kira-kira ada sampai sini ada yang sudah mengerti kira-kira apa argumennya kalian kalau misalnya pihak afirmatif dan pihak negatif. Ada yang mau menyuarakan pendapatnya, ya terserah aja, it's really free. Enggak ada judgment di sini, enggak ada yang salah, enggak ada yang benar. Oke, Okay, so kalau misalnya belum ada, saya coba di bagian afirmasi dulu. So, what do I want? What are my ideal world looks like? Jadi saya mau, so I want, saya mau tetap ada ini orang-orang itu untuk tetap live their own traditional ways. Jadi tetap bekerja untuk korporat atau bekerja untuk orang lain. Why? Karena firstly, becoming entrepreneur is not for everyone. Nah, entrepreneur kan yang sudah saya jelaskan tadi, kalau entrepreneur itu it takes a lot of risk lah, karena entrepreneur you do not have a safe net gitu, safety net. Karena entrepreneur itu have to have a mental yang kuat gitu untuk face those failures that may occur. Nah, thus it's not for everyone. That's the first layer of reasoning. Second, entrepreneur is not really safe option for a career option, apalagi misalnya orang-orang yang backgroundnya tidak stable gitu, misalnya backgroundnya yang comes from a middle to lower class society. Nah, di situ kan mereka what do they look for is financial freedom kan, mungkin orang yang berada dari keluarga yang kurang mampu itu ya pasti dia punya harapan itu bisa dapat pekerjaan yang mungkin low risk, yang mungkin lebih lebih bisa give them stable income, karena mereka tidak mau, mungkin mereka trauma dari keluarganya mereka yang already covered in debt gitu, so they do not want those risks again, they have that trauma, they do not want those risks, thus they it's better for them to not be an entrepreneur. Thirdly, mungkin karena ini namanya glorification, which means semua orang itu mau jadi entrepreneur. That is what we don't want, karena it will create a peer pressure towards this kind of people. Nah, ini nih vulnerable actor-nya di kita punya emosi hari ini. Vulnerable actor-nya itu adalah orang-orang yang mungkin memang mentalitinya is not to be an entrepreneur, atau memang yang berasal dari keluarga yang kurang, middle to lower class people, yang mungkin tend to seek safety, yang seek financial safety rather than financial risk, high risk as an entrepreneur. Nah, kira-kira kalau dari kalian apa? Ya, coba ini ada host yang chat di grup, yang chat di Zoom, chat boleh elaborasi kira-kira kayak gimana? Nah, it's true. Nah, ini ada hostnya kita bilang kalau government pihak afirmasi should explain how the glorification of entrepreneurship isn't accessible and it's kind of harmful. And the opposition, which means the negative side, should explain why it's still accessible and why it can bring more benefit. Jadi dari argumennya afirmatif tadi yang mengatakan bahwa entrepreneur itu isn't accessible for everyone dan kayak mungkin it's a very high risk yang tidak ada safety net-nya. Entrepreneur kan itu pekerjaan yang tidak ada safety net, tidak ada garansi, tidak ada insurance untuk cover begitu. Kalau misalnya bisnismu atau freelancingmu itu fail, bagaimana? Tidak ada yang cover kau debt gitu. Sedangkan kalau misalnya kau bekerja di korporat atau kau bekerja di suatu perusahaan, kalau itu perusahaan bangkrut ya you will have compensation gitu pasti dari government. dari pihak pemerintah pasti ya give you, kalau misalnya call laid off gitu ya pasti ada backupnya dari pemerintah, dikasih kok mungkin subsidi and you can get another job gitu. Nah kalau misalnya dibandingkan kalau begitu pihak government, then the negative side should terlibat gitu, kalian bisa terlibat kalau misalnya entrepreneur itu accessible. Oh, entrepreneur itu it doesn't always have to have a really big modal, atau kalian nggak harus bilang kumpul investor untuk fund your business gitu. You can start small gitu. You can start small. Ada banyak di resources lain. Nah, ini ada juga dari Michelin. I think that even there are people who... Gak apa-apa sih, Michelin. Bicara misalnya. Masa cuma saya ini. It's okay. Dan host juga ini harus bicara dong. Masa cuma chat di grup. Di grup chat. Nah, ini Michelin bilang, I think that even there are people who would like to become entrepreneur, they could start by working as an office worker first somehow and then gain money or knowledge and become an entrepreneur they dream of. Ya, betul, betul juga ini yang Michelin bilang. Nah, kalau misalnya itu entrepreneurship itu accessible, you can still work as an office worker. Misalnya kalau misalnya memang kau berasal dari keluarga yang that bisa fully fund you as an entrepreneur, you can maybe start other source of fund yang bisa kau cari, yang misalnya kau bekerja dulu, terus itu uangnya kau bisa jadi modal untuk kau jadi entrepreneur that you dream of gitu. Cocok sih misalnya. And then dari host, kalau host bilang, kalau opposition bisa bilang masih accessible G, even diglorifikasi, karena semakin diglorifikasi, semakin banyak ideas yang bisa di-gather about entrepreneurship. Nah, beda nih juga on the ya, status quo sekarang, pandangannya orang sekarang sudah berbeda. Jadi entrepreneur doesn't mean bakalan punya own companies. Sekarang orang bisa punya small business, gak apa-apa juga. Dan culture-nya juga promoting growth. Yo, betul nih. Kalau entrepreneur doesn't necessarily have to have big companies atau punya investor. Nggak tradisional nih gitu entrepreneur. Sekarang entrepreneur itu pandangannya society itu sudah grow. Seperti tadi yang saya bilang, entrepreneur itu sangat-sangat luas. Entrepreneur itu nggak limited to be a businessman or a businesswoman. Kalau entrepreneur itu bisa freelancing juga. Kan freelancing itu dari zero, tidak ada modalnya freelancing. Ya, your own skill nih yang that you currently have, you know, and then how you promote yourself. Bahkan sekarang kayak social media tuh yang saya dari tadi glorifikasikan terus. You promoting yourself, namanya personal branding. Kok personal branding di social media it take 0 cent gitu. Tidak ada harganya untuk kok promote yourself di your social media. Kalau memang misalnya you have a bakat untuk misalnya design, atau you have bakat untuk misalnya mentor debat, misalnya kau pintar debat, you can promote yourself on your Instagram gitu. Atau kau pintar bahasa Mandarin, kau pintar bahasa Korea, kau bisa promote yourself as a tutor on your social media gitu. Dari situ kan kau bisa pelan-pelan grow gitu, karena sekarang itu sangat-sangat accessible sih. Jadi nah, karena dari pihak negatif tadi sudah bilang kalau sekarang sangat accessible, kalau misalnya social media itu, misalnya promote yourself on social media itu basically take 0 cent, tidak ada biayanya. I mean, on the other hand, itu yang pihak afirmatif, government side the house, itu juga bisa ribat bilang, ya kau share ke social media itu it also takes money gitu, karena social media not only you yang ada di social media, ada banyak orang lain juga yang you have to compete against. So what do you have to do? Sebenarnya ada banyak aspek, nah, kalau misalnya mau personal branding di social media atau mau branding your own OL shop, nah, online shopmu, kau mau brand, itu kau harus pakai Insta Ads, kau harus pakai endorsement dari artis, so their argument about free branding on social media is not relevant anymore, karena social media itu sangat-sangat banyak sekali orang, dan the probability of you being overshadowed by bigger freelancer misalnya, atau bigger online shop, atau bigger institute in the social media itu sangat-sangat besar. Apalagi kalau kau start dari nol, dari zero followers, or even from your personal branding, ya followers dari teman-temanmu gitu, sangat-sangat minim gitu ya. Jadi kayak building trust and building branding on social media is not an easy task negative side of the house claims gitu. Is there any other ideas yang mungkin bisa kita explore? Oh ya, ini juga dari host ada bilang kalau government bisa bilang even if it's accessible, as free as posting on social media is still harmful karena range competition-nya. Ya, Cocok Mianda saya bilang juga range competition-nya besar sekali. Orang posting di social media, tapi mereka still have capital to paid promote. Sedangkan beberapa orang cannot afford IG ads or FB ads yang mahal banget. True. Sedangkan glorification yang terjadi di status quo itu sudah parah sekali nih. Yang peer pressure terus orang bilang sukses itu bisa banget dalam waktu yang cepat. Ya, betul. Peer pressure itu bisa banget dalam waktu yang cepat. Seperti itu tadi. Siapa namanya tadi itu? Timothy Reynolds. Umurnya 19 tahun tapi sudah bisa pegang 100 juta. Notice kalau misalnya dia itu orang privilege, dia saya kuliah di Binus uang kuliahnya saja sudah 30 juta. Uang pangkalnya 30 juta. Itu saja sudah melebihi dari mungkin uang UKT-nya kita di Unhas selama 6 semester. Selama 1 sampai 8 semester mungkin lebih daripada uang pangkalnya saja. Itu that shows to you kalau dia itu berasal dari orang privilege. Terus orang-orang yang berprivilege lah yang kayak begini, yang create those societal peer pressure. Kalau orang bisa sukses, orang bisa kaya dari entrepreneurship gitu. Tanpa dia enggak bilang dia juga, bilang saya orang tua dari kaya. Dia kayak humble himself. Like, I do not come from a very wealthy family. But you have the privilege gitu. Your family is stable enough already to fund you. Bagaimana guys? Sepertinya sudah ini nih, apa namanya? We already talk and discuss about this glorification of entrepreneurship from both sides, dari government side dan juga dari negative side. So I give back to the moderator. Thank you.
Okay, we think that it's all already wrapped up. Thank you so much, Kak Stephanie, for the insights about this matter bank, about how the romanticization of being entrepreneurship di glorify untuk sekarang ini. Jadi, if you guys don't mind, please open your camera because we would like to do documentation. You open cam. Okay, Manda, are you ready to screenshot?
Sudah, Liz. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. Anyway, guys, do not forget to fill out our post experience survey that will be sudah ada ya. Oh iya, sudah ada di grup. Jadi silakan untuk mengisi post experience survey melalui Google Form. So I think that's all. Thank you so much, guys, for participating.